y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was going to say. Sisters got happy.
I love them old church.
Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and
singing.
All of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
We're going to take our thoughts from the book of James and look at something that is, I think, one of the main challenges for the church today, in particular the Church of Christ. I remember as a young man being taught that the Spirit was no more than just words. That the Spirit was intellect. And I remember how divisive and polarizing it was for the culture of people. One culture would say that it's emotions, and the other would say that it is culturally different. But in the interim, Satan was busy.
Mm-hmm.
And Satan was active.
Yes.
He worked diligently to establish rules and procedures that brought about a religiosity, if you will, into the church, in which we became more routine than we became spiritual.
Man.
The book of James is written, and it starts in the dispersion. It starts to those who are scattered. It is encouraging in James chapter 1 that we read and we find that we are encouraged that if we lack wisdom, let a man ask of God. We are instructed in James 1, 6, and 7 that when we pray, that we are to pray having faith in God. And we're warned by James that when we pray, and we pray doubting, and we pray not understanding the power of God, that we're not to expect to receive anything from God. For a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. And then he begins to talk about true religion. And he finally begins to get to a thematic or thematic call of the book of James, which is faith. Whether you're a Calvinist and you begin to teach that you don't have to have faith, James says that faith without works is dead.
Amen.
And I believe that one has to have faith and works. And I don't care what scholars may try to maneuver around, but James makes it clear that there must be faith and works.
Yes.
Now, in verse number 26, he clearly says something that we have skipped over because we are so ready to condemn. We're so ready to strike out. We're so ready to hate and love. He makes a valid point that also must be taught out of the book of James. He says, as the body is what? As the body is dead without the what?
Without the spirit.
Spirit, so is
faith.
Faith
dead
without works.
Man.
I stop by to tell you that we can have all the laws and all the commandments in the world, but if we don't have the Spirit of God,
yes,
the body will simply die.
Man.
Because the body can't function without the Spirit. Because it is the Spirit, am I right about it? It is the Spirit that giveth life to the body.
Man.
Jesus puts it this way in John chapter 6, round verse number 61. He says, it is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. These words that I speak, they are spirit
and life.
They are life.
Man.
So the church then, the body of Christ, must not only have law, but it must also have
spirit. Man.
When you come to a group of people who are all law or Pharisaic, they omit the spirit, which giveth life to the body, and will sit and look and stare as if God has never done anything for you.
Well,
And I know that God has done, if you don't do anything else, he's done enough for each and every one of us.
Yes.
The devil is a lie. And I don't apologize that I live in the spirit. I obey the laws of God. And I believe that they all work together, which then produces faith.
Man.
By the spirit that I have. When you have just love, you will omit love, which then contaminates the spirit. James is trying to teach them, as you read in James chapter 4, whence does this stuff come from? Where does hatred come from? Where does envy come from? Oh, you have all these laws in place, but even in that text, in James chapter 2, you'll find that there's a man that they had money, that they were sitting in the front of the church, and the poor folk were sitting in the back of the church. When you read, you'll find they were fighting and infighting and wars and rumors of war. There was hatred and malice and all types of things going on in that Jewish church, and there they were claiming to have law, but they had omitted the spirit. And so just as the body without the spirit is dead, so is faith without works. You must have all of the components in order to have what God has put together. And God did not establish a dead church.
Man,
he said, you are lively stones. It's okay to be thankful that God has done something for you.
Yes.
It's okay if you don't do nothing else. He's done enough because he died on Calvary's cross for your sins and my sins.
Man.
And every now and again when you're sitting down, there ought to be something that makes you say, thank you, Jesus, for what God has done for
yes.
you. God has established your goings from the time you were born unto this very hour. And every now and again, you didn't do it by yourself. Every now and again, you ought to be able to say, thank you, Jesus.
Yes,
God has protected you from your enemy. He's blessed you from trials and afflictions. He's helped you when you didn't have help. God has been good to every one of us.
Man.
If he doesn't do anything else, we ought to have a spirit in us of praise and thanksgiving because God has shown us good.
Man.
And I don't have any problem just telling somebody every now and again, isn't God good?
Yes, sir.
Isn't God good? You might be struggling, but I don't have a problem shouting amen sometimes.
Yes.
And I don't have a problem with you not saying amen, but he's been good to me. I got to say thank you, Jesus, every now and again, because I have come to realize that when you have a church that does not have the spirit, you don't have Christ.
Man.
The church cannot exist without the spirit. It is the spirit that quickens.
Yes.
But a church without the spirit won't praise God.
Mm.
They will legally come at a certain time to worship.
Mm.
They will have a set time to leave. They'll have a set time to do this and a set time to do that, but they'll never stop and really inquire about what God is doing in each other's lives.
Man.
They will legislate and they will rationalize everything, but never really look at the person that they are and why they are where they are this very day. Well, what do you mean? Every now and again, when you look at the scriptures, you'll find God saying to you that I want you to worship me in the totality of your spirit, your mind, your body, and your soul.
Yes.
Every day you get up, every day you move in the presence of spirits. Do you know that? Every day, you remember the scripture in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse number 12, we wrestle not against what? Not against flesh and blood, but against what?
Principalities.
Yeah. Am I right about it?
Yes,
there's some principalities that's sitting down when you got up this morning, put a target on your back, and want to take you out of. And even right now as I'm speaking, there's some spirits that's saying, I ought to kill him right now. There's folk that don't mean you any good, but God will lift you up.
Man.
God will strip you in the face of your enemy. God will give you words in the due season.
Uh-huh.
And for that sometime, you ought to shout, thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
God's been good to us, and am I right about it?
Man.
God established his kingdom with a spirit of can do. You remember they had a servant by the name of Caleb. You said that Caleb had a different what?
Spirit.
A different kind of spirit. He moved through a young boy by the name of David, and David looked at Goliath and said to himself, while he's standing here trembling and looking around, don't you know the God that we serve? He moved through the prophets. They gave their life. They shed blood. They died for his church to be built. He died and gave the ultimate price, for the church was built on the blood of Jesus
Man.
Christ. Am I right about it?
Yes, sir.
Matthew 26 and verse number 26, this blood is the blood of the New Testament shed for many for the remissions of sin. Am I right about it? This church had a can-do spirit, and they didn't just sit around looking funny,
man.
But they knew that when God said in John chapter 4 and verse number 4, that 24, that God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him
yes.
in spirit and in truth. Now watch this. Over in James chapter 2, verse number 26, he said that the body without the spirit, it would be dead. Am I right about it? Well, listen, let me tell you something. That spirit, there's a big S, God's spirit, and there's a little S. The big S is God's spirit. The little S is your spirit. John 4, verse 24, God is a spirit. They that worship him in spirit, there's big S. God is a spirit, little S. They that would you that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Well, what is that? That's with all your heart.
Yes.
All your mind.
Man.
All your emotions.
Uh-huh.
I see a bad word, didn't I? All your intellect. All your emotions. All your beings. Your heart, mind, body, and soul. How to worship God.
Man.
Just to bring your mind to church. And every now and again, you have never shed a tear because of what God has done for you. Something's wrong with that picture. For you to sit in a church in the body of Christ for 3-5 years and have never stood up and said, Lord, I'm sorry. Something's wrong with that picture.
Man.
To have never seen you testify of the goodness of God. Something's wrong with that picture. For you to sit back and critique and argue and fuss all the time. Something's wrong with that spirit. Something's wrong with a spirit that won't praise God.
Man.
And there's only one spirit I know that won't praise God. There's one spirit I know won't praise God.
Yep.
Every chance he gets, he talks down about God. Everywhere he goes, he argues and fuss about God. Every chance he tries to tear up what God meant. There's one spirit that won't shout, thank you, Jesus, and Lord have mercy. And
Man.
That spirit is the Antichrist. That spirit, he says, when the spirit leaves the church, when it leaves the body, the baptism pools will shut down. When that spirit leaves the body, folks will sit up and look like all they're waiting on you to do is to be quiet. And sometimes I really don't understand. If you're that distraught in your spirit, I don't even know why you came to church in the first place. We already had scribes and Pharisees that tried to worship God, add laws, and got themselves in trouble. And in fact, he said that type of spirit in Matthew 23 and verse number 5, he said, it was that type of you. He said, warned you, scribes and Pharisees, for you can pass the land and the sea to make one proselyte, and when he's made, you make him twice as likely to go to hell. To teach a man nothing but law and not the spirit of God and the love of God is to condemn his soul to an Old Testament mentality.
Man.
Which was all law and no spirit.
Yes.
Well, what do you mean? I say every now and again, we ought to be able to raise our hand and just say thank you, Jesus. Because he brought us a mighty long way. Am I right about it?
Man.
Every now and then, we ought to look at the words of Jesus. When it said in Matthew 5 and verse number 4, bless are they that mourn. There's some folk you have never seen mourn. They're too tough to mourn. If they cry, they turn into icicles on the way down. Blessed are they that mourn. For they shall be what?
Comfort.
They shall be
comforted.
Am I right about it? The lamentation writer writes that his soul hopes. It hopes in the Lord. There are emotional scriptures that wait on God. But in fact, I believe when we sit down and look at the scriptures, we'll find that the eunuch in Acts chapter 8, after he had read what happened to Jesus, they said it was reading in Isaiah 53, whom have believed our report, and to whom of the arm of the Lord, the arms of the Lord revealed, he should grow up before us as a tender plant, a dry root out of the ground. When we should see him, there is no form of comers that we should desire him. They talked about, he read how he had been beaten. He read how he'd been led from hall to hall. He read how they had humiliated him, spit on him, smitten him, and stricken him, and it moved him and said, who
Man.
Are they talking about?
Yes, sir.
And every now and again, one of y'all ought to be able to say, what has happened to Jesus
Man.
In the house of God?
Yes.
And when Philip began to talk to him, he started right where he was. And the eunuch heard, he said, well, you're talking about baptism. Well, what's stopping me from being baptized? Well, you see, what had happened is that he not only heard the law, but he was also engaged in his spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And when the law and the spirit come together, it will produce a valid work. And so he asked the question, well, here is water. And Philip and the eunuch went down in the water.
Man.
And watch when he got. But when he got out, the Bible said he went away
rejoicing.
Man. He went away rejoicing. You ought to be happy that you saved. You ought to be happy that you found the Church of Christ. You ought to be happy that God blessed you, because you didn't have to find the Church of Christ. You could have been lost, but God made a way. You connected through his word, through his spirit, and God through his blood, and you are a member not because of your own power, but because God made a way.
Man.
How do you know? How do you know? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 4. If our gospel is hid, it is hid to them that are lost, and whom the God's liturgy of this world has hid it from them. There's a reason folk can't hear spiritual preaching, can't hear about the emotional side of preaching. They cannot realize that there was joy in the church, that folk did say amen, that folk did have a good time in the Lord, that folk were happy to be Christians, that folk were walking around acting they were scared God was going to kill them. They were happy that God saved them. When I worship God, I'm not walking around nervous because I think God going to strike me dead in the house of God. I'm having a good time. I'm thankful because I know it's by his blood, his stripes, that I'm healed.
Man.
And that's enough for me to just come in and smile every day. And if you don't want to pray, I praise him for you. Amen. Amen. Man. So this divide is not only found in James, in which we all men and read over that the spirit without the body is dead, or the body without the spirit is dead. So then faith without works is dead. I maintain, I submit to you and beg the question, that there is not a work that you can do as a divided group of people in Christ. In other words, there is no white church of Christ, no black church of Christ, no Latino church of Christ. There is just Church of Christ.
Man.
There's just one church.
Yes.
One Lord, one faith, and one baptism. There's just one church. And we're brought together in that one body. Mm-hmm. And that one hope, and that one spirit. And that spirit, we have to be on the same page, that we understand that God loves every one of
Man.
Us. When we have this law, Paul wrote to the church of Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse number 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and the tongues of angels,
mm-hmm.
and have not love, I become but a sound or a tinkling cymbal. You can walk around all day talking about God this and God that, but if you can't love everybody and we can't come together in the spirit of Christ, you're nothing but soundness about. I was telling a young man the other day, it is trying for me to hear messages of love and hope from folk who hate me in the same breath. It is taxing for me to look sometimes at the animosity and the hidden threat of Judaism running through their veins, of Judas working in the modern day. But hear them talk about one church. What's the problem? I hear you talking about one church, but I don't feel the love that we ought to have together as one church. I don't understand why you over here, and I don't understand why you purposely try not to listen and see me, and I don't understand why you purposely try to affect my ministry, and I don't understand why you purposely run me down. I don't understand. Then get up and talk about, oh, we got faith and works. There's something wrong in the house, and what I believe has happened is that the Spirit of God has been omitted and has been replaced by the law, and the law without the Spirit is nothing but death. It's nothing but death. Oh, that's all they had in the Old Testament. They had plenty of law. But it lacked the ability to bring hope and joy and relief from sin. There was no grace under the law. There was no hope. For every year, whatever they thought you did or done, can roll them back again on the way out. We must leave this place where we only have law and come to a place that we can express how glad we are that God has saved each and every one of us.
Man.
God says it this way in Ephesians, I believe, chapter 2. He says that you were dead in your trespasses and sin, but I quicken you. You were strangers to Israel and the commonwealth. You were aliens. You had no hope, but how'd you quicken me? My word it sunk down inside of you. My body bled. It was open for you. I wore thorns on my head. I reconciled you back to the Father. I gave you the ability and the capacity to pray for yourself. I brought you redemption of sin. And the last thing that we need to see is James play out again. Where is classism against classism? Where is person against person? Where folk are fighting and fussing and talking. brothers, not only from an emotional standpoint, but it also from an edifying standpoint. Not only should we be emotionally in love with God, I don't know about you, but I'm emotionally in love with God. When I think about how good he is, sometimes you have to start smiling sometimes, just about how good he's been to you. If God's been good, can you raise your hand tonight and say, God's been good to me? Amen. God's been good to me. Every now, don't you think about when you've been through some stuff, how good God showed up and what God did for you? I'm emotionally in love with God. I'm not only the fact he forgave me, but he restores me. He helps me in spite of my enemy. In fact, he says he'll make a table in the presence of your enemy. And I'm glad that I serve a God.
Amen.
That will not only lift you up, but he'll put a new song in your heart. Am I right about it? That's why we're saying, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply staying within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me. Now safe am I. Love lifted me.
Man.
Good Christianity don't push people down. It does not destroy. It does not tear up. But good Christianity lift folk up out of their horrible pits and miry clay. Am I right about it? And so I'm not only emotionally in love, but I'm also thankful that I am edified. And my edification comes from its connection to the Spirit. I know we know all the books and all the chapters and all the verses, but the edification that God wants is connected to the Spirit that's inside of the man. I'm going to show you scripturally when we look at the word edify. It comes from the original word edifice. The edifice, the summa in the Greek, is the body. The body houses the puma. It houses the spirit. And so the one is edifying. It means that something inside that is housed has been aroused and is expressing itself and manifesting itself in the body.
Man.
That's why sometimes you're sitting down and somebody's singing and you just started crying because you've been edified. Because your edifice has been affected by what's inside. But if your house is empty and there's no spirit, no thankfulness, no gratefulness, then all you're going to do is when I preach, just look up in the air like I ain't talking to you. But I'm talking to three people that's got the spirit in them. And when I'm teaching God's word, they say, oh, Lord, thank you, Jesus. He right. The Bible's right. Am I right about it?
Man.
You've been in the house before. You've been in the house before. You can go in all you want to. But a house is not a home until you have some little feet running around in there. Am I? Sometimes a dog will turn your house around. I will put my dog out yesterday. I got home at the hard day. He done bit the cable cord. And the folk called me and said, preacher, hope you been praying. I what you mean? We're going to charge you $150 to fix that cable cord. And I was in the lawnmower. And so I passed the law. He got to go. But see, the love in the house, the kids started to come with tears in their eyes. And then the wife started talking, I won't cook until he's back in the house. And love started to move. And all of a sudden, love met spirit. And before you knew it, he had his house back. And I was sitting there licking my wounds. Y'all say amen. But if it wasn't for the spirit of love in the house, love would have shown up. And if you understand that, then you need to understand what's going to bring us together is that we have a fervent love one for another because we love him.
Man.
When we get to that point, we'll stop building churches and start merging churches. It's not just among races. I don't know if you ever heard of internal. Have you ever heard of internal racism? That's where people of the same race hate each other. Yeah. Yeah. My biggest enemies are not folk that don't look like me, but my biggest enemies are folk that look just like me, that talk like me, and walk like me, but hate themselves. And they hate you trying to do something. You start telling them, the rules of life say, the laws of life say, if you play by the rules and get education, then you ought to be able to get work. So you go out and get your doctorate degree, and you work hard and diligently and study God's word, and before you know it, I'm against doctor. I don't believe in doctor. I don't think it's necessary. You don't need that. You know, the Bible said we're all brethren. Let me tell you, you can make brethren a law and make brethren a title in and of itself if you're not careful. But the problem is not the law. It's the use of the law to try to hurt somebody else. It's the spirit. Well, let me give you some Bible. I'm going to be funny now. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, though I understand all wisdom, have all faith that I can move, all mission, have all faith that I can move mountains, but I don't have love for my brother. It profit me absolutely nothing. You might have a scripture to condemn everything you think you condemn. But when you have the wrong spirit with the right scripture, you get the wrong results. You have to have love and law. And the Bible says that when we have love and law, it comes through Christ.
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, he said, now what the spirit is, there's also liberty. And I like that. Christ is that liberty. And where the spirit of Christ is, there is freedom. I want every person to know right now, as long as the Spirit of God is running through this world, and it is, because he's alive sitting on the right-hand side of the Father, he sent the Holy Spirit, John 16, about verse number 14, how be when he, the Spirit of truth, shall come. He sent the Spirit. As long as the Spirit of God is alive and well, you don't have to worry about what folk think about you. You don't have to worry about what's going to happen to the church. The church is going to be just fine. God's Spirit is not a losing spirit. It's a conquering spirit. Man. No, we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Yep. And as long as there's a God, and I know there is, everything is going to be all right. Man. Can you look at your neighbor and say everything going to be all right?
Everything going to be all right.
Y'all say like y'all said, y'all ready to go home. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Everything is going to be all right. I want to say to this church that as you are really starting over, don't build this. Don't try to operate God's church and disrespect the Spirit. Don't try to. We meet at 7 o'clock or 10 o'clock on Sunday, 7 on Wednesday night, and the legislature way to heaven. But make sure that you incorporate and you move by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
And obedient to the law. You know them. Those that are just law-minded. Most folk I know that are extremely ignorant claim to be professors of the law. You can't tell them nothing. You can tell them this is God's word. And these are tools to assist you and understand, I don't need that. But then you describe the Pharisee would be in trouble. You don't need that. All I need, the only time they talk about the Spirit is to deny what the Spirit puts in place. But I don't need a preacher. What does the Bible say? How shall they what?
Here.
Here without who?
Preacher.
A preacher. Can't no man tell me nothing.